Hello everyone, thank you very much for watching this live event, a new episode in the Software Architecture Fundamentals series, and today we discuss about software deployment, which as you will see is also very, very relevant in both software architecture and software development. So I see a lot of confusion in the software developers' world, considering that the software deployment is now not relevant or is independent of how the software looks like. Sometimes people refer to as DevOps or infrastructure and consider that's totally unrelated with what the software looks like. But actually what you will see is that it's very relevant, and it's a strong connection between how software looks like and where we deploy it. And that's basically what we discuss in this session. I hope you will find this really useful, and you will see that with experience you gain this feeling of how strong the connection is between the two aspects, software development and deployment. If you watch the event live, don't forget that you have a live chat there, so you can always start discussions or ask me questions in the live chat directly. If you are watching the event afterwards, as usual, you can ask me questions in the comment section, or you can find me as well on Twitter or on LinkedIn. You can follow me there and we can discuss as well. If you have longer questions, I will answer in a separate video. If you have shorter questions, I will try to directly answer you in a comment. Thank you very much again for being here. So let's start with where we do deploy software. We always refer to environments. You will hear about environments here, environments there. What kinds of environments do you have? Well, you can have one environment, you can have multiple environments. Hopefully you have multiple environments. I will immediately explain why. But you will always refer to this where you deploy your software as being the environment where you deploy it. And you will at least have one environment where you deploy the software, that is the production one. So we can simply just name this one the production environment. Well, I would like to actually have it as a rectangle. And that's at least the only environment you have. Now, hopefully, as I will explain, you have more than just the production, because otherwise everything you test is in production. And trust me, I've seen cases where developers didn't have a UAT or a development environment where they could test separate environments. They had only the production environment. So everything going into production, it was also where the solutions or the new implementations could have been tested as well, which is not really great, because if you do test on production, it means that you can screw up things, and if you screw up things and you can not put them back quickly, then you have a big problem. And maybe that works with small organizations, but with big organizations it doesn't work, because you don't want to keep a lot of people production standstill, like they cannot work because of you. So that's why we have multiple environments when we work, and we potentially at least have three environments. So yeah, you can have as many as you want. You don't want to have too many either, because the more environments you have, the more costly the process of developing your software is. So you don't want to have a lot of them. But from my point of view, at least you would need to have a user acceptance test environment and the development environment. So that's basically on the development, where you can do whatever you want. You can play with the data, you can delete it, you can whatever you want you do on the development. Then on the user acceptance test, that's kind of a mirror of production. This is where you kind of deploy your software when you know it's ready, and you still expect it might have bugs, but it's the place where you present it to your customers. So you don't want it to be a lot different than production, just because then you will lose the trust you have to your customers. So remember, when you discuss with a non technical person, which usually our product owners are, or at least not necessarily the product owners, but the stakeholders are usually non-technical people, remember that they will very easily lose the trust if they see things not working correctly, and that will generally happen in the dev environment. So that's why basically, even if we know that it's not a big deal, you will not easily make your stakeholders, non-technical stakeholders, understand it's not a big deal that they see something not working correctly here. So you preferably have a separate environment that we call a user acceptance test, where you deploy everything, so that then after the user acceptance test, if the stakeholders agree with what they see and everything works correctly, then you move it into the prod. Okay, that's it. Now, this is more related to the process of the development side, but I wanted to mention this because it's still important and still related to the deployment, and you will see immediately why. For example, one of the main important things where you find the separation between environments different is where you basically, I explained, this is where the users work with the real data. This is basically where you test mainly. This is actually where you test. And this is where you present it to your users. But the problem is, at today and in the later episodes, I will discuss with you, I will tell you multiple ways in which you deploy software. So we will discuss the possibility of deploying your software on virtual machines, the possibility to deploy your software in containers. You will see that you can do that in private clouds, or you can do that in public clouds. So why is that really relevant? First of all, I want to make sure that you understand that all the environments you use for the same application, so the development, the UAT, the production, and other environments in case others are needed, then you really need to make this mirror as much as possible the production. So what will happen is that in some cases you will have less resources for the development environment, which is natural, is normal, because you don't want to spend a lot of resources for the development, since of course the development, maybe it's only used by 50 developers, I don't know, I just said a number, while the production is used by 300,000. And that's basically, it's normal that you don't need too many resources on the dev. But what happens is that you don't want to have a totally different infrastructure. So you don't want to have a totally different infrastructure. Like here you have containers. I will discuss later what containers are, don't worry. And here you have virtual machines, which again we will discuss later. So UAT is the most of the time product owner playground. They validate the stories done by devs, which is new implementations or bug fixes. That's how we call them, stories. It is supposed to be more stable than dev environment. That's true also. So I do agree with that. But what I want you to remember is that never use a totally different way of implementing the environments, like the infrastructure. Don't make it container wise based on the dev and virtual machine based on production and UAT. Sometimes besides UAT and dev, in applications where you have performance testing, where performance testing is relevant, let's call it like this, in some applications performance testing is more relevant than in others, but there are applications where it's really important to implement performance tests. So in that case, what I do recommend is having a separate environment completely where you implement, where you write and you run the performance tests, and that should really mirror the production, because if you don't mirror the production, then it's not really clear what performance you are actually what are the metrics you are actually counting on when you run the test. So it might actually work awful when you run it into the test environment but run perfectly in production, or the other way around. So that's an important aspect. While in case of the UAT and dev, like the dev is the playground of the developers, and indeed UAT, as you say, Elise, is the playground of the stakeholders. Usually they play with the data there and they accept the new implementations and the bug fixes created by the users. You might have less than the power you have on production, because you know, again, on production you might have 300,000 users, and UAT on dev, they only need to support a lot less requests, like maybe you have 50 developers that are working on those, and maybe 20 more stakeholders, I don't know, I just invented some numbers. But again, the most important thing I wanted to start with is make sure you don't have a totally different infrastructure, because the way you implement your deployment infrastructure is really important, and it relates a lot to how the software looks like, as we discuss later in this episode and in the next episodes. So that's the first very important idea that you need to take into consideration. Now let's get rid of discussing UAT and dev and production. Now you know what an environment is and what we refer to when we say environment. So we want to understand what is this environment actually in general. So which are your options to implement the environment? Well, basically we started with years ago having what we call now bare metal. So bare metal is actually, it's not some kind of music or like heavy metal. It's just it's just installing your software directly on the machine itself. So like in my case, I have a notebook here. Imagine I install some kind of a software directly on this machine, then it means I'm using bare metal. It's just having the server, in case of it was that time of a backend solution, which is no longer the same, you just installed it on that operating system running directly on the bare metal. But now we don't have a lot of cases like this anymore, because bare metal is kind of not that flexible to manage. So instead of having the bare metal to make the management of the resources easier, we invented virtual machines, and now instead of using directly the system on which we have the operating system installed, over that we are installing what we call a virtual machine emulator and VMs, which is actually an abbreviation from virtual machine, is just a way to spin up individual. You can just imagine them as being individual logic computers installed on a specific system. And the advantage, first of all, of the virtual machines is that if you have a bare metal and you have, I don't know, 16 gigabytes of RAM memory, and I don't know what kind of CPU, then you can just stay with that. You can't make it smaller or bigger. But if you have a virtual machine, you can first of all play with it, and you can have a virtual machine that is more powerful than another. Secondly, is that you can install and replicate the virtual machine, the same basically virtual machine with this data, on multiple physical real computers. And that's really important in terms of cloud technologies, because that's basically when we work on a specific cloud environment like AWS or Azure or Google or Oracle or whatever else. We have plenty of options today, I don't know, Alibaba or so on. When we use one cloud, we just refer to our virtual machine, and it just looks like we are working on a computer, but we don't know precisely which is and how does the physical machine look like. So we are just using that virtual machine, and for us it's simply very transparent where is it installed. And that's very important, because as you will see later when we discuss cloud environments, we might have multiple virtual machines in totally different regions of the globe, which allows us to create a regional implementation of our application, which in cases in the cases of big systems, it's pretty relevant to implement both performance, raise the performance of the application, and as well make your application redundant. So nowadays we don't really discuss a lot about bare metal anymore, at least not in terms of backend solutions. You install on bare metal your own software, like my browser, it's installed on the bare metal, my IntelliJ is installed on the bare metal as well. But when we discuss software, then like backend solution you implement, you will implement it most likely in a virtual machine. Secondly, the virtual machine, what I said first is that you can customize the way they look like depending on your usage. So you may actually make a virtual machine to be more powerful or less powerful than another. And when we will discuss again cloud solutions, you will see that cloud solutions such as AWS, they actually even offer you predefined virtual machine templates so that you can choose depending on what you want. If you want a virtual machine with more GPU, then you will choose one with more GPU. Do you want a virtual machine with more RAM? Then you will use one with more RAM. Depending on how much resources you want, you will of course pay less or more, but you have the option to choose whatever you wish. And that's first of all. The second thing is that you can manage the virtual machine. So for example, I can totally create my infrastructure linked to the software I deploy on it. So imagine that now my software, when I say I deploy some software in the virtual machine, that actually means that when I deploy my software, I directly install it in this virtual machine, which is nothing more than just a virtual computer running an operating system. And of course, the operating system, together with all its configurations, they are part of the virtual machine itself. And now my software is also installed within that. So what actually happens in this case is that I can completely replicate this virtual machine. So if I have, say, this is an instance of the virtual machine I've spinned up for my deployment, then what I can do is that I can make my software, well, didn't want to do that, but I'm not really sure how to work with it. Yeah, when you actually do something like this, you can actually replicate. And if I have my environment here and I have maybe 100 customers, because there are software companies that simply install their software and they have some hundreds or even thousands of customers. When you get a new customer, you can simply just deliver it together with the infrastructure, because you can simply just replicate the same configuration you have for the virtual machine, and you can of course then customize it for a different customer, but it makes things less complicated if you just create it together with the infrastructure. And what happens is that basically you can even create all these virtual machines, you can create them manually. And that was basically what happened at some point in the past. Developers were actually manually configured the virtual machines. But later than that, we actually even invented the new term that is called orchestration. And what this orchestration actually is basically an automatic way of creating, updating, or deleting, managing in general, virtual machines. So when I'm now trying to say create a software, and I know I'm deploying my software in a virtual machine, and I know I have some kind of specific configuration for the virtual machine, which might even include the networking between the virtual machines, then I have the possibility using different tools to create declarative scripts, and these declarative scripts, they create the entire infrastructure for me. So if I just want to replicate that infrastructure again, I just have to run again the scripts, and they create my infrastructure, and they install whatever I need on the virtual machines, including the operating systems and the software that I want to deploy there, which is pretty awesome. So before, the bare metal servers had the names, but now virtual machines are treated like cattle, a saying from the DevOps world. Yeah, it basically, when I was very, very young. I don't think I'm actually very old now, but it was many years ago, maybe 15 years ago, when I started working on software, and I was working on an advertisement agency. I was taking care of their servers as well. At that time, I was not actually just a software developer. I was simply implementing websites with PHP at that time, and I was taking care of the company servers, and they actually had one big server that they called the mothership. So yes, I can relate to that. Before, when we had the bare metal, we actually called them names. So I had that server called the mothership, and on the mothership we had absolutely everything. So that was good on one hand, because it was easy for me to take care of it. On the other hand, when the mothership crashed, I had to stay up to 3 a.m. in the morning trying to solve the problem, because the mothership didn't actually have a replica itself, so it was only that mothership. And when it failed, then everybody was stuck because they couldn't access any data. So yeah, with virtual machines, it's a little bit easier to deal with this kind of stuff, because you can simply replicate the virtual machine whenever you need it, and then you have a nice even load balancing between them if you want, or you have a failover. We don't get into such situations anymore. But it was those were nice days. I remember those days were actually good ones. So going back to our software deployment. So we do deploy software, and one of your options today is to deploy it in virtual machines, which are not complicated to manage. Basically, you have the possibility to orchestrate them automatically. There are a dozen of softwares out there that you can use, and it really depends on what kind of solution you use, because again, I will later discuss, and you will see that we might have public clouds, we might have private cloud solutions, like on-premise solutions, and depending on what your infrastructure is, you have different solutions, various solutions that you could use. And I don't want in this stream to discuss them, first of all, because it's not really something I'm an expert in, but knowing what you can do is something that any T-shaped software developer and software architect needs to know. So let's discuss at least the top of the mountain view of these possibilities. So you have these virtual machines. Now, the problem with virtual machines is that you basically, it really looks like your computer in which you have to install the operating system, and you have to configure the operating system, and you have to configure the networking as well. And you have a dozen of other configurations that are not necessarily related to your application, which makes thing a little bit more difficult when it comes to what shall I do if my application gets stuck and I want to restart it. Because in that kind of a situation, if you have your application deployed on a virtual machine, it's basically easier to completely to restart the application than completely restart the entire virtual machine. And even though in some cases it might be fast enough, it definitely is faster if you can restart only the application, but the application sometimes contains some caches. They are not necessarily alone. It's not necessarily don't just have to think about your application as an independent executable code that doesn't leave any trace behind. Your application itself might have some kind of data it stores, some of its own configuration, and so on and so forth. And in some cases, you want to delete that as well, and restarting the application in a virtual machine might be a little bit more complex than it looks like because of this. So restarting completely the virtual machine might take a lot of time. Restarting the application inside the virtual machine might be not that comfortable. What should we do? So now we go to the next layer of the abstraction. So what I'm actually building for you here in the end is a diagram that shows you the level of abstraction in software deployment. So let me write here so that everybody remembers what we are talking about. These are the levels of abstraction in software deployment. So that's basically what we are building here in a diagram. So I was telling you that the less abstract, actually, the abstraction goes this way. So this way is from less to more abstract. Okay. So let's say that this arrow represents the abstraction. And what I will later tell you is that the other way around, so that the abstraction, you will see it helps you. Let's move this orchestration inside. So we know that the virtual machines can be orchestrated. And I don't need this now anymore. And I will just tell you that the other way around, you have more flexibility in configuration. So the second arrow, the one I draw on the left, is flexibility in configurations. So you can basically configure more things when you go less abstract. The most things you can configure are on the bare metal directly. The less things you can configure are on the upper layers that we will discuss. But the more flexibility you have, the more complex the deployment becomes. So when you go up and you make things more abstract, you actually make the deployment easier. And you make the deployment easier by hiding some of the configurations that you basically do. But it basically, in that case, also gives you less power, so you don't have the same possibilities as when you go less abstract. So when we will end with this diagram, which is the plan for the today's lesson, is that you understand which are the layers of abstraction and what are they giving to you. And then what we will work with this is basically help you understand, depending on what kind of software you have, why is it better or worse to choose a specific kind of deployment. So that's basically the link between what software development and software architecture is to what software deployment is. That's basically what any T-shaped software developer and software architect should know. So yeah, that's what I was saying. Now, what happens is that you want, again, to go more abstract because you want to basically be able to work as fast as possible with your application. So instead of virtual machines, what we will hear that we very often today use is containers. So sometimes, by the way, when we discuss virtual machines, you will find this referred to as infrastructure as a service. So let me put it in a corner here and say virtual machines is somehow equivalent to saying infrastructure as a service. And when we have containers, is something referred to as containers as a service. So containers, and here you have a name that's most likely very well known today. Everybody knows and or hears or will hear at some point about Docker, because we very often use Docker today. maybe put it like in between parentheses, because this is probably the most often used implementation for containers. I actually don't even remember if I've ever used something else than Docker. And containers, they basically isolate your application with its configurations, and they allow you directly create and run the container on a specific virtual machine, basically having your containers sharing the kernel of that virtual machine, which in terms of having a more homogeneous infrastructure is better, because first of all, you know that the applications you deploy, they are basically relying on the same operating system behind the scenes, and at the same point it makes things easier, because if the application is a small one, then it will be very fast not to restart it directly, but to simply completely destroy the container and create another container. That's because the container, being more abstract itself, it contains less information, so it's smaller in footprint, so it can be destroyed and recreated faster. And that's one of the biggest advantages of containers, and that's, as you will see, why we often use containers today when we implement software as services. I will, however, tell you that containers are not a silver bullet. So I don't want you in general in software to take anything as a silver bullet, because in general in software, when we choose a specific technology or approach, remember what I'm always telling you, and I probably repeated this in each and every episode of the series, you are only making a compromise. So choosing a technology or an approach or a technique in software is making a compromise. It's never one specific, always considered a technique that is the best for any situation. Always when you choose, you have to make your to have a good judgment and understand which is the compromise you make. So what I want to make even more stronger here is that I don't want you to consider that containers is something that is better than virtual machines in all the cases, and I don't want you to consider that virtual machines deployment is no longer used or won't be used anymore. Both of them are approaches that are different and they apply to different situations, just that one of them is more abstract than another, while the other one offers you more flexibility than the other. So the virtual machine, being less abstract, offers you more flexibility in configurations, but containers being more abstract, they make things easier in terms of the deployment. And same as for the virtual machine. So first of all, when containers were invented, developers discovered that what they have to create the containers, and they have to manage them. So they have to delete them, they have to, I don't know, they have to manage them in general, they have to spin them up. Sometimes when we scale the application, I will discuss later, you just spin up multiple containers. So you have to create containers, you have to be able to manage them. So what's that basically? It's orchestration. So same as for the virtual machine, developers implemented the orchestration for containers. So the orchestration for containers, where you basically hear the probably the most known name is Kubernetes. So Kubernetes, something that I might demonstrate later, also abbreviated as Kubernetes, is the most known and most used solution for orchestrating containers today. So we also have Docker Swarm as a solution, but in my experience and with whoever I discussed, it looks like Kubernetes is the most used solution today, or alternatives, customizations of Kubernetes in different clouds, because sometimes different clouds offer their own as a service Kubernetes implementation. You might have that as well, but it's still Kubernetes behind the scenes. And that's basically idea of managing containers. And then besides all this, we even have a more abstract way of deploying the software. And this abstract way of deploying the software, more abstract, is called serverless. So let me put it here and say serverless. Okay, and this is where you will find abbreviations such as function as a service, backend as a service, and even software as a service. And we have orchestration here as well. But before going into serverless, I would like to explain which are the possible serverless options and what actually serverless is, because there is a lot of confusion in my experience here on what serverless is in general. So first of all, what I would like to say about serverless is that even if the name serverless suggests that there is no server, that's not true. So there is always a server behind the scenes. So serverless doesn't mean there is no server, but it actually means that it looks like it's no server. So for the developer in that case, you don't have to take care of anything. Even the orchestration itself, like in case of the container, is somehow behind the scenes done by the solution in which you deploy your application. It looks like there is no server, so that's where the name serverless comes from. But of course, there will always be a server there taking care of what happens. And what I sometimes compare this with is, you know, you have you might have, depending on where you live, seasons like winter or autumn when it's colder outside. And inside your home, you have radiators that are heated with usually hot water. Like in our case here, for example, when winter comes, we have these radiators that are heated with hot water. But that basically, that hot water is not in all the cases produced in our homes. It comes from somewhere outside, and heats all the apartments or all the homes in the entire region. So that actually looks like serverless for me, because when I feel that my radiator in my room gets warm, I don't see any fire. So I don't actually have, it's for me, it's transparent for how does that radiator get heated. And that's serverless for me. It looks like there is no one heating the radiator. We are just, the hot water comes into the radiator in my home, but I don't see anyone making a fire for that. But that doesn't mean that there is no fire out there heating that water. So actually, serverless is a solution where the server exists, but it's simply transparent for us that the server exists. Another analogy that I've seen for this diagram of abstractions in software deployment is the one with eating, say having a pizza. So imagine that you take the ingredients yourself. You take the flour, you take the eggs, you take whatever you put on the pizza. You take the tomatoes and you prepare the ketchup yourself. In that case, is like you are going bare metal. So in that case, you are less abstract. What does that mean? It's basically that you have the most flexibility, because then you buy your own ingredients. So if you want a specific kind of flour, then you can buy a specific kind of flours. If you want to use a couple of eggs, or you want to use three eggs, then it's your decision how many eggs you use. You prepare, you use whatever ingredients you want and what quantity you want. You might have recipes where you can use different kinds of quantities for the same preparation, and somebody likes to have more sugar or less sugar. And if you go with cooking that yourself, that recipe yourself, let's say you are cooking a pizza, then you go bare metal. You basically have the biggest flexibility. However, even if you have the biggest flexibility, you have to agree that is the less comfortable approach, because you have to prepare it yourself. You have to buy the ingredients, so choose them, prepare them, cook them, and so on and so forth. So it's everything that you are doing. Now, if you, however, instead of taking all those ingredients, buying them to prepare your pizza, you are buying the pizza just there are, you know, you go to supermarket, those packages where you just buy the pizza as is. You might put some more little bit of ingredients above it, you put it into your oven and you cook it. So in that case, you are a virtual machine. It means that you don't have to actually buy all the flour ingredients yourself. You just buy the pizza itself, you maybe customize it a little more, and then you put it into the oven, and then that's the pizza, you can eat it. However, you can clearly see here that even if it's easier because you don't have to prepare the pizza yourself, you just a big part of it, have it already prepared, you still in this case have less flexibility because you cannot decide everything. It's still some customization you might implement on your pizza, but you cannot choose everything. You cannot choose what kind of flour you use, how many eggs, and so on and so forth. So going to virtual machines, unlike bare metal, is that you gain more. It makes life easier, but you are less flexible. Going down to the bare metal, you gain more flexibility, but it's of course more difficult. Then if you go up there, even upper in the stack of layers, in terms of abstraction, you have containers, which is kind of you are ordering a pizza. So I'm basically just calling someone to prepare the pizza completely for me and just deliver it to me. Now in that case, the only thing I have to do is take the pizza and ensure that I have a chair and a table so that I can eat it, and maybe some fork and a knife, and that's basically it. So I take it almost, it's done, and I almost have to do nothing. The only thing I would have to do is wash the dishes later. Or I can even go serverless and I can go out and eat the pizza in a restaurant. And in that case, I have the biggest abstraction possible. I don't have to provide a table. I don't have to provide the chairs. I don't have to wash the dishes after. I'm just going out and eating. But I have the least flexibility possible at the same time. So that's a good analogy again in what these layers of abstraction mean, and that should give you an idea on later when we discuss about software and where we deploy it, why we choose to deploy a specific architecture in a specific kind of abstraction layer. Now, going back to serverless, so I actually told you a bit of it. So I told you that we have this situation where you just put your logic implementation, but you don't care at all about the server behind the scenes, and that's why it's called serverless, because it's transparent for you. But what I actually want to complete further in my explanation is that you have these multiple ways of understanding serverless out there, and it's not always about having some kind of code. The function as a service, so what we call function as a service, is the code itself. What is a function as a service? It's actually a piece of code that is triggered to be executed upon an event. That piece of code can be implemented in a specific language. So if you take, for example, Amazon Web Services, AWS, you will see that AWS has this nice service called Lambda function, which is basically their implementation of function as a service. Almost any kind of public cloud today has a solution to implement function as a service, and with orchestration solutions such as Kubeless, for example, you have the possibility to have functions as a service and orchestrate them also in on-premise solutions. I will go later into more details. But the idea is that now you can implement this kind of architecture again almost everywhere, in almost any kind of cloud environment you have, be it public or private. The idea is that you have this piece of a function that is triggered upon an event, and the event can be calling an HTTP endpoint, maybe it can be a timer, it can be adding a specific message in a queue, and so on and so forth. So this kind of event is configured to trigger a function. So that function basically will execute when that specific event for which it was configured happens. What does that mean? It basically means that at that point, the environment in which you configure the function as a service, behind the scenes configures and spins up a container and executes that piece of code as an application itself. That's why, as you will see, and you will hear that often, in most cases, we care a lot about the cold time, which means how much time it takes for that container to spin the first time to be up and running. And you will see that very often, even when you kind of configure it very well, you still have this case where the function takes more time to spin up at the very beginning, like it might take 9, 10 seconds, or it depends on many factors what the last time will be. And then if you call it the second time, then with the same event, it will basically execute instantaneous, like in a couple of milliseconds. That's because that first time of a few seconds, it was what took the environment to spin up the container for you so that it can execute the function. And that's a quite really, really, really important aspect because, again, as I will also detail later, it's really important to know when to use serverless in terms of functions as a service, because if you have an event that is not triggered often enough, then what will happen is that you will rather go into performance problems, because if it happens, let's say now, and the same event happens in 10 minutes from now on, it's very possible that in between the two, the container has been spinned down, because in the case of serverless, what the cloud does behind the scenes is that at some point, if there is no event any longer for that specific function, then the cloud, to spare more resources, it simply puts down the container. So next time it has to again put it up. So it again will take a few more seconds. So when you use this functions as a service, serverless architecture, if you don't know precisely how your function will work, you might get into the situation where you implement a function and then you have performance issues because your app will constantly wait a lot of time for the function to be up and running. So that's again something for later to detail, but as an idea is one of the links between should I or shouldn't I use a specific abstraction layer in terms of deployment. Some years ago, not many years ago, maybe 4 or 5 years ago, when this serverless was just released, developers just started to hear about serverless, and everybody was like, it always happens with everything, every kind of technology that's new and sexy I have to use that, I have to use that. It's like always happening with software developers when they have something new, they want to use that because that's the best. which is obviously almost never true, but that was the case about 5 years ago, and people was I don't use containers anymore, now functions as a service is the future. And it became true that it's actually not necessarily obviously part of the future, but in most applications, especially the real-world complex applications, not those simple demonstrations like tutorial demonstrations, functions as a service are just complementary to containers and to virtual machines. And depending on the architecture you have, you will implement a function only there where it really makes sense. And if you really understand how to do that, then you will have a really good performant solution. So event-driven can say serverless. So it's not an equal sign between event-driven and serverless, but indeed functions are triggered by events. In case of event-driven, you can have an event-driven architecture that is implemented with virtual machines. The event-driven doesn't imply that you use serverless. You can have only virtual machines, you can have virtual machines and containers, you can have an event-driven system based on all the deployments, all the way you deploy your code. Serverless, and especially now function as a service, because that's what I was discussing, it actually means that you have the cloud having your piece of code, managing it, creating the container upon an event. So you can say that a function as a service is event driven, because indeed a function function as a service will always be triggered upon an event, but you can't say that all the event-driven systems are serverless. I hope I was clear with my explanation. Now, you also have serverless in terms of backend as a service, and sometimes simply called software as a service. It means that you have some kind of functionality provided as a service by the cloud that you have simply use, and it looks like you only have to implement the client. So imagine this. Imagine I have to create an application in a website that recognizes shapes in a picture. So it simply, you upload a picture and it tells you that you have a pizza there, or you have a ball, or you have an umbrella, or whatever you have there. So I might choose to implement that feature myself, but I might decide that implementing all the machine learning behind the scenes and the database I need to train those models, might be quite complex. So do I really want to do that? Or maybe I can find some kind of feature already implemented that gives me that, of course, paying for it. And you can find out that there are already cloud solutions like AWS offering that for you directly. So that's a good example of a backend as a service. In that case, you use the backend implemented by the cloud. You actually have an implementation behind the scenes and you use it, you pay for it, but you don't have to implement it yourself. It's considered part of serverless because it looks like the code, the logic of the backend doesn't exist at all, even though that's only transparent for you. It's just that you are calling an endpoint which is served by the cloud, and the backend is implemented and is somewhere running in the cloud. It's just that you don't manage it yourself. The cloud manages that backend for you. And even the more the solution that is called software as a service, that's actually when you have any kind of software you provide to your application, to your users, without implementing it but serving it directly from the cloud. And there are a lot of solutions for that as well, like even free solutions. When you use, for example, the online Word solution or whatever that is, PowerPoint and so on, you can say that you are using software as a service, so that basically that software is provided and you can directly use it. That's what you will hear a lot in terms of serverless, when it comes to serverless. But in terms of software development, you will most likely face the function as a service and the backend as a service terms. So you will sometimes in your systems have to take the decision that you might want to implement some kind of piece of code as a function. And I will tell you some nice use cases in the next episode, of course, because this one is ending soon. But what we will do in the next episode is that now that we know and we understand this distinction between configurations and the abstractions and the configuration layers on the diagram, we will take some use cases and we will say when is or potentially might be better to use that on a virtual machine, on a container, or serverless. And we will discuss and debate on these use cases, and that will basically give you the option to compare those use cases with something similar you implement in your application. And then when you will have to take your own decision on something similar, you will basically know, depending on the architecture of your application, what would you choose for the deployment? Serverless, containers, virtual machines. And of course, for each of these, we will go into more details and discuss what is the best approach, what can we do to make it better. So are you planning to make any course on Kubernetes and containerization? I didn't plan an episode specifically on implementing Kubernetes and containers, but I think that it in this stream, but I think that it might be a good idea, and it might give you more, at least for those of you who might not have seen containers, might give you a better feeling on what containers are. So yes, let's say that after we might decide the theory, conclude the theory part and decide based on use cases what would be the approach, maybe we can take virtual machines, containers, and serverless, and why not have an episode for each of these layers, and also show you at least a theoretical example, because again I will repeat myself, but there are dozens of solutions there. So if I'm showing you one solution to say work with virtual machines, that's definitely not the only one. But if you understand how that works, then all the other potential other solutions, they work very similar. So I think it's a good idea to actually have some hands-on as well in one of the next episodes with all three of these, so that it's easier for you to understand maybe when you also see some something that we can apply. So let's discuss the theory and then indeed try in one of the next episodes to apply that as well, so you have a good way of complete picture of our discussion, what happens here. And I hope that will be helpful. Otherwise, let's conclude for today. So I think we at least managed to go through all the diagram and discuss all the layers, made you aware of them, discussed them from the top of the mountain, understood the relationship between abstraction and flexibility, and understood the fact, very important, that one is not better than the other and that you will use them depending on how your systems, software's architecture look like, and give us the opportunity in the next episode to take some of these use cases and discuss based on them if you would choose the abstraction layer, which abstraction layer would that be, or would you use a combination of those abstraction layers. So we will also discuss this of course related to what kind of architectural style you choose, if it's a monolith or it's a service oriented architecture. Cool. Thank you very much for joining, and I hope I will see you also next week, and up to that point, have an excellent time for study further. Cheers.